Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking about equity. We've talked about the types of equity, we've talked about how we record the basics of equity, and we've done a lot of examples for issuing common stock and then repurchasing common stock as treasury stock and what happens when we later resell those shares. Now it's time to turn our attention to the other major category of stock, and that is preferred stock. As we start our discussion of preferred stock, we need to mention the fact that it's very different than common stock. Common stock is sold to owners who have a specific ownership share in the company. They get voting rights relative to that ownership share. They get profits equal to that ownership share. A preferred stock is different. It's an alternative to debt. They get no ownership stake in the company. What they get instead is a set dividend. And if the company liquidates, then we pay off the debt holders first, and then the preferred stockholders second, and common stockholders last. That's what preferred means. Not that it's better or that it gives them more control. It gives them no control. It just means they get their dividend first, and they get any liquidation value before the common stockholders. Now, usually, preferred stock is issued with a very large par value, $100, $200, $50, whatever. And this time, the par value actually has some value. It's not just some number we made up to satisfy the government. What we do is we take that par value times whatever the stated percentage is, and that's the dividend each shareholder is supposed to get. The good thing, from a company perspective, is that if I don't have the money, I don't declare a dividend. If I don't declare a dividend, I don't have to pay a dividend, and I don't have to come up with the cash. This is what makes preferred stock a good alternative to debt, because with debt, you're going to make those interest payments or you're going to default. So you have to do it. You have to come up with that cash somehow. With preferred stockholders, I just don't declare and I'm good to go. When we issue the preferred stock, I have to make a choice though. Are we going to make it cumulative or non-cumulative? If it's non-cumulative and I miss a year, so let's say that this current year is a really bad year and I've got no cash and I declare no dividend. Well, when I get into next year, if it's non-cumulative, those preferred stockholders say, hey, you missed last year, and I say, tough. You don't get the dividends for the years I miss. Those are non-cumulative. If they're cumulative, the opposite is true. If I miss a year, I have to go back and pay them what I missed before I can pay any dividends to my common stockholders. If we miss a year, we call it being in arrears. If I've got cumulative preferred stock and I'm in arrears, then I owe all of the amount I'm in arrears, plus I would owe the current year's value before I can pay anything to my common stockholders. And that is really what makes these shareholders preferred, is because they get all this dividend before the common stockholders do. Now, under IFRS, the classification is a little bit different. You see, they usually end up classifying preferred stock as a liability, even though it's a form of stock. Why? Because IFRS has two specific rules. In order to be classified as an equity, the preferred stock has to be one, non-redeemable, which means you can't ever go back to the company and say, my par value is $100, give me my $100. Or it has to be redeemable only at the issuer's option. So let's say you own 10,000 shares of my preferred stock. You come in and say, I want my money. And I say, no, I don't want to give you your money now. You go away. But if I choose later on to redeem them, I can call you up and say, you know what? Never mind. I don't want to keep paying you a dividend. Why don't you bring in 5,000 of those shares? And I'll go ahead and redeem them. If it's non-redeemable or only redeemable at the company's choice, not at the stockholder's choice, then you can call that preferred stock an equity. Otherwise, it has to be put in as a liability. So these same rules hold for other puttable options. A puttable option means that the person who holds this commercial paper or this stock or whatever can come into the store or into your office building and say, I want my money. I don't want to be an owner. I don't have this debt anymore. If you have to repay them at their discretion, then you have to classify it as a liability, regardless of whether it's a share or a bond or a debt or whatever it is. Now, the issue with preferred stock all revolve around dividends, which means we need to talk about dividends. Now, dividends are a way that we can pay back our owners some of what they have invested in the business, either because they gave us money and now we're going to give some of that money back, or because the company has made profits and we're going to give some of that profit back to them. Most corporations pay at least some of their profits each year as a dividend. Not all of them, but many do, because their owners want their money back, and we have to oblige. They're the owners. Now, one word of caution about dividends. Once you start to pay them, you must continue to pay them. The market expects that you will continue to pay these dividends to them as owners every single year. And if you miss a year, watch out. Your stock price will take quite the beating. You'll see companies occasionally that don't pay dividends and don't want to pay dividends, but they've had a buildup of cash and the owners start to clamor, if you're not going to do anything with that money and invest in some other big assets, we want it. And this happened to Microsoft a few years ago, where they had built up a bunch of cash from very successful sales and business practices, but they had no recent projects or current projects that really needed all of this money. And so their investors started to push, we want you to disperse that as a dividend. And Microsoft tried to say, we don't do dividends. If you want your money back, go sell it to somebody else and they'll give you their money. But the investors kept pushing. And some of the big investors with lots of shares started to push the board. And the board finally said, all right, we will do a one-time dividend. And Microsoft came out with their announcements and they were very clear. We're going to do a one-time, only once, never again, just this one time, because you asked for it, here's a one-time dividend that we're gonna pay, but only this year, we're not gonna do it again, it's just this one time. And that sounds like overkill, and in a way it is, but really that matches up very well to how they did this dividend declaration and the dividend announcement to the press, because they didn't want to set up this precedent that they would pay a dividend every single year. Because again, once you set up that precedent, you are going to keep paying those dividends. Now, companies can pay dividends in several different ways. The most common is cash, but we can also pay dividends in property, some of our assets, or we can pay them by giving them extra shares of stock. So let's say Apple's having a bad year, they want to pay a dividend, but instead of having a lot of cash on hand, what they have is a bunch of extra inventory. So instead of sending every shareholder X amount of dollars, they send everybody a new iPhone. And that's your dividend. You get a new iPhone. We don't have the money, we'll use the inventory. And that's cheaper. If I give you the inventory, you can tell everybody, well, the market value of these iPhones is $200, so you're getting a $200 dividend, when in reality it only costs them $100 to make. So I can get away with maybe slipping this under the wire and making my investors happier with a little less. Stock options, we're giving them shares of stock. So for every one share you have, you now have 1.10 shares or 1.5 shares or something like that. So that gets a little bit harder because you end up with people with percentages of shares, but it's another way to pay out a dividend without having to go into your bank account. So let's take a look at how we do the journal entries. We're going to start with cash dividends, and then we'll talk a little bit about stock dividends as well. We'll keep it simple at first and just do common stock. Then we'll add in preferred stock so we can make it more exciting. So let's see here. On June 1st, MSR has decided to declare a $100,000 dividend. The date of record is August 1st. The date of payment will be December 1st. Now, three key dates are shown here. The first is the date of declaration. This is whatever day they make the announcement, we're going to pay a dividend. And as of that day, they are legally obligated to pay a dividend. So right then, we create a dividend payable. The date of record, August 1st, that's the day that we take down the names of our shareholders. So whoever owns the shares on August 1st, they're getting the dividend. So if you sell on July 31st, you're not getting the money. If you buy on August 2nd, you're not getting the money from the dividend either. So you have to be the owner of record on that day, whatever date is set in the announcement, to get the dividend that they're going to pay. And finally, we have a date of payment, in this case, December 1st, and that's the day the money goes out. And it used to be the companies would mail out a bunch of checks. What usually happens now is we send a bunch of money to an investment bank along with a fee, and they actually distribute it for us so that as a business, we're not wasting our accounting and finance department's time on sending out checks when they should be worried about the next year's financial numbers and cost analysis, etc. Let's do the journal entries for each of these 3 days. And we're going to start with the entry on June 1st. So on June 1, the date of declaration, we are legally obligated to pay this dividend. So we're going to create a dividends payable for the full amount of the dividend. And since it's a corporation, I'm going to put that into my dividends account. It's not an expense because I'm repaying my owners, but I'm not going to take it out right out of retained earnings either because I want to be able to keep track of all of that at the end when I do closing entries. Declaration of a dividend. That's the journal entry on the date of declaration. Next, we have the date of record. And the journal entry looks like this. Nothing. From an accounting perspective, we don't care who owns these shares because all we're keeping track of is the fact that we owe a dividend and we pay a dividend. That's what we're worried about. The finance department or the investment bank that's going to send out these checks, they're frantic on this day, writing down names and getting all the information they need. But from an accounting perspective, we don't care. So journal entry wise, there's nothing going on that day. On the date of payment, the entry is really straightforward because we're making a payment. So I'm going to credit cash for $100,000 and I'm going to debit the dividend payable. Paid cash dividend. The journal entries are really straightforward. Where we get into trouble is when somebody calls and says, hey, how much of this dividend am I going to get? And that's the other piece from an accounting perspective that we want to keep track of is how much does each shareholder actually receive? So to figure this out, what we need to know is the total amount of the dividend, $100,000. And then we also need to know the number of shares outstanding. Now let's see, on the date of declaration there were 100,000 shares, but on the date of declaration we're not concerned with per share or who gets what, we're just concerned with the total amount we're going to send out. So I'm not concerned at this point with the fact that I had 100,000 shares. What I'm more concerned with is the fact that on the date of record I had 200,000 shares issued, 5,000 of those for treasury stock. So I've got 195,000 outstanding on the date of record. So if I want the dividends per share, I'm going to take the $100,000 total dividend and divide by 195,000. And that's going to give me 51 cents. And that will be my dividend per share. Let's make this more interesting by throwing in preferred stock. So at the beginning of year six, MSR has 20,000 shares of $100 par value, 5% preferred stock. Unfortunately, because of an economic downturn, they haven't been able to pay dividends in year six or year seven. But finally in year eight, things are starting to look up and they're gonna pay a $250,000 dividend. We wanna make the journal entry if the preferred stock is cumulative and if it's non-cumulative. To really start this process, the first thing we need to know is the dividend owed to the preferred stockholders. So that's 20,000 shares times a $100 face value or par value times 5%, which is the amount that we owe to them. So that comes out to $100,000. And this is the amount that we owe them every single year. It's what we're supposed to pay. Now that we've got that number, let's start with non-cumulative. So let's see, I'm gonna declare a dividend of $250,000. So I'm gonna take that out of dividends. Well now let's see, because it's non-cumulative, the fact that I'm 2 years in arrears doesn't matter because I only owe them the current year's dividend. So I'm gonna record a dividend payable preferred stock for the $100,000. And the rest would go to my common stock shareholders. Declared $250,000 dividend. Now, if it's cumulative, things are a little bit different. Now, I'm 2 years in arrears. So I owe them $100,000 for year six and year seven, plus $100,000 for the current year. So I owe them a total of $300,000 in dividends. So if I just declared a $250,000 dividend, then it all goes to them. Now, as a last question, let's say that we get into year 9 and we want to pay a $100,000 dividend to our common stockholders. How much of a dividend would we need to declare to have $100,000 that could go to the common stockholders? Well, in order to pay them, I'd have to get the preferred stockholders all the way paid up. Now, at the end of year 8, I still owed them $50,000. That's the last of the year 8 dividend, because I owed them $300,000, I only paid $250,000. Then I would owe them another $100,000 for year 9. So I owe the preferred stockholders $150,000. So I'd have to declare at least $150,000 just to satisfy the preferred stockholders. Then I'd add in what I want to give to my common stockholders, and I would need to declare another $250,000 dividend if I wanted anything left over for the common stockholders. Now, the rest of the journal entries are straightforward. I simply debit the payables and credit the cash, and off goes these checks to all of these stockholders. All right, that wraps up our discussion of cash dividends. We need to talk a little bit, though, about stock dividends, and that's what we'll do in our next segment. I'll see you then.